Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's 9:30, so I'm going to start. Welcome to Advent Lutheran Church on this sixth Sunday of Easter. It is good to see you all here, especially as we gather this morning, not only to worship, but also to honor the service that Fran Zanis has given to this congregation in the years of being our church secretary, our administrative assistant in the church office. So, announcements. We've got, there they are. Men's breakfast coming up this Saturday at 11 o'clock. No, I'm sorry, at 8:30, coffee available at 7:30. Church council meeting is this Saturday, May 11th, at 1 p.m. I'm glad I read the bulletin this morning because my brain happened to stick an extra one on the front of that. I have it in my calendar at 11, but it's actually at 1 o'clock. So, you know, these announcements are very helpful things. Last day of Sunday school is May 19th. We're honoring graduates. So if you have a college or high school graduate this year, there are forms found on the round table in the narthex. World Music Concert, the Detrimental Quartet, that's June 16th, Friday at 7:30 p.m. Vacation Bible School announcement in there. I'll lift to your attention. And another announcement. I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge Arthur Zimmerman, Cindy Fry's father, passed away. And the service for him was this past Thursday up in New York. So please keep her and her family in your prayers. And then we have a new bishop for the Southeast Pennsylvania Synod. Lynn Rocca Grande and Nancy Hill and myself were the representatives for our congregation at Synod Assembly. There were rostered leaders and representatives from all the congregations in the Southeast Pennsylvania Synod present. And we conducted the business of church. We approved a budget, we heard reports, we elected synod council members. It's just like a congregational meeting, only for the synod. And we elected a new bishop. Pastor Brian Penman is his name. He's a colleague that I've known for many years, who I have tremendous respect for, and I'm quite pleased that he was elected bishop. I think he will do a good job. Lynn or Nancy, would you like to say a word in front of the congregation? Are you sure? Can you use a microphone? Because we've got people online.
I got the call to go, reluctantly wondering, 2 days to sit there and vote on things I knew nothing about, but I am glad I did it. I think anyone who has an opportunity to go and do an election, it's well worth it. Very informative. It was neat to see all the different services that are provided by the ELCA and the state and national. I now understand how everything functions. Met a lot of wonderful people, and it was just informative. It was enlightening. It was good to see where our money goes, how they spend it, how they use it, how they need it, and a lot of the organizations, I didn't realize we touched so many places with what we do there. And it was just, I'm just saying, if you ever get an opportunity, it's very enlightening. And it was well worth the time.
Yeah, what the Synod does is literally an extension of us as a congregation. and all the other congregations in this synod. The synod, you know, sometimes gets kind of like Big Brother. You know, they're the hierarchy. They're the lofty bishop. But no, the synod exists as an extension of all the congregation. That they are a cumulative effort of what we do, and they do it in the region of the Philadelphia area, Pennsylvania, and on the national level. So when we put dollars and we designate that to the broader church, it makes a huge impact. And it's we do incredible ministry that other churches, other denominations don't do or don't do as well, like Lutheran World Relief. Yeah, our synod is made up of five counties. Yeah.
I didn't realize we're included with Philadelphia, Bucks, Montgomery, Delaware, and Chester.
And Chester. Yep. So. All right. So, and then finally, last but certainly not least, and again, this is the announcement that you have the power to shorten, and you have yet to take that power into your hands. Does anybody happen to know what a God sighting is? Can you raise your hand if you know what a God sighting is? I don't see many hands. That means I really need to drill. Are you sure? Do you know what a God sighting is? Oh. I still don't see all everybody's hands up, so I'm going to make this one a... How much time do we have here? What's that? It doubled today. There you go. Do you see what he did? He just shortened my God sightings announcement. Some of you in here lengthened it because you didn't raise your hand. And if you honestly don't know, that's fine. I'll just take the time to explain it. But right there, you got to come at me. If you think this announcement should be really short, show me. Show me. Like doubling the chain. So anyways, a God sighting is any way that you see God active in your life, helping you through difficulty, giving you joy, anything in between. There's a table where the God sighting chain is. There's scraps of paper. There is a sheet of paper that lists a variety of different God sightings. And those are the kind of hit you over the head with a 2x4 ones. Those are the big ones. Anything can be a God sighting. If you eat a bite of food and say, God, that is good, that's a God sighting. Because every breath we take, every bite we eat, every moment, every second of our lives is a gift from God and can be a God sighting. So at the end of your day, get into the practice of identifying, naming God sightings that happened during that day. And write some of them down. Grab a stack of a handful of the strips of paper, write them down, bring them back to church, and staple it on the chain. I want to see that chain grow. I want to see it go all around this sanctuary. I want to have the problem of wondering, where are we going to hang more chains? And this is an absolutely fundamentally important spiritual practice. It is scientifically proven by hundreds of studies over the past 10 to 15 years that in the studies they call gratitude is the word they use. But it's God sightings for us as Christians. That if you do this, if you name a God sightings at the end of your day, even if it's naming one, what was your one God sighting for the day, and you do that for a month, you will notice a change in your life. It will happen. It will deepen your relationship with God. It will give you a greater sense of God's presence in the world around us. And, you know, my newsletter article, newsletter is about God sightings. There's a link in there that will show you I think it's like 31 or whatever different benefits of doing acts of gratitude. This is important, and it's important for this church. Everything we're going to do over the next 2.5 years as we continue the strategic mission plan builds upon the ability to recognize God doing things in our midst and seeking God's guidance. If you recognize God active in your life, you'll be able to listen to God and God's guidance, especially when we ask the question of what are our gifts? What are the needs in the community around us? How does the community around us need to be loved? How do we bring God's love to the broader community around us? We don't have this in our back pocket. When we ask those questions, we will either not hear much, or we'll be misguided by the dark parts of our hearts. Gotta get those antennae up. Do God sightings. Is that long enough? I was going to go longer, but you all need to give Gary thanks because he brought the time down. There you go. There you go. And hey, if I'm going along and you're thinking, wow, pastor's really going on for a long time, call me on it. Say, hey, I did God sightings. We did God. Look at the chain. It doubled. Call me out. Say, pastor, can it? All at once, pastor, can it? 1, 2, 3. All right. Names to add to the prayers of intercession later on in the service. We've got from the first service, any names to add, those who need to be prayed for? Dave? Ann, George, and you said Amy, Victoria, Peter, A-N-D-I. Thank you. I appreciate that. Mom. Okay, mom. All right. Pop. Grandma and granddad. Donna Marie. Mommy and Mama, and two. Puma. Okay. Mo. Okay. Donna. Fran and Eugene. Any online? Let's start. Please rise. Alleluia! Christ is risen! Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia! Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the wellspring of grace, our Easter joy, our Easter and our joy. Amen. Please face the back of the sanctuary towards the baptismal font. Look, here is water. Here is water of life. Hallelujah. Immersed in the promise of baptism, let us give thanks for what God has done for us. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your voice thundered over the deep and water became the essence of life. Adam and Eve beheld Eden's verdant rivers. The ark carried your creation through the flood into a new day. Miriam led the dancing of your people past through the sea into freedom's land. In a desert pool, the Ethiopian official entered your boundless baptismal life. Look, here is water. At the river, your beloved son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By the baptism of Jesus' death and resurrection, you opened the floodgates of your reconciling love, freeing us to live as Easter people. We rejoice with glad hearts, giving all honor and praise to you through the risen Christ, our source of living water. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Look, here is water. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
O God, you have prepared for those who love you joys beyond understanding. Pour into our hearts such love for you that, loving you above all things, we may obtain your promises, which exceed all we can desire. Through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Young at heart in the congregation who want to come forward. Come forward. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm doing well.
How are you?
I'm doing excellent. Especially because I'm here in church with you and with all these wonderful brothers and sisters in Christ. So, all right, let's take a look at this. Sing a new song to the Lord, who has done marvelous things, whose right hand and holy arm have won the victory. Sing a new song to the Lord, who has done marvelous things. Do you know what that word marvelous means? Any
good?
Yeah, great. Good, happy, wonder. All right, so marvelous, the root word in marvelous is to marvel. To marvel is to be kind of like, almost like surprised or impressed, kind of blown away. Like when I think of marvel, it's like watching somebody do a really cool stunt, like somebody do a somersault or an acrobat, or somebody do a really fancy dance that just looks marvelous to look at, like it's amazing. So God does marvelous things. Amazing things, things that kind of make you go, things that make you happy or might be surprising in a good way. Can you name some marvelous things that God does?
That he made the world. That's marvelous. That he made this whole entire world.
That he made this whole entire world. That is marvelous. I love that answer. That he did what? He counts everything? That's pretty marvelous too. I love that answer. Everything around us, God keeps track of it. He counts it. Yeah. You have do you have a thought as to what God has done that is marvelous? No? Well, take a guess. And that he made all of us. That is pretty marvelous too. And not only does God love us, God, how does God feel about us? Oh, it's bigger than nice. He doesn't make mistakes, right? How about back to that question? He doesn't make mistakes. So when God makes us, we're not a mistake. God made us because God, how does God feel about us? Yeah, God loves us. And that, for me, is the most marvelous thing there is. That God loves me, and God loves you, and you, and you. And who else does God love?
Jesus.
Yeah.
Everyone.
Can you point to, I've been pointed at, you and you have all been pointed at and said, God loves you and you are marvelously made, marvelously loved. Who else can we point at right now and say, they are marvelously made and marvelously loved? Anybody else? Me? Yep. You got it, exactly. So let's stand up. let's say to them, let's point our hands, let's go like this, say, you are marvelously made. You are marvelously made, and you are marvelously loved. Amen. Thank you for joining me.
First reading is from Acts 10. While Peter was still speaking, the Holy Spirit fell upon all who heard the word. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astounded that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles, for they heard them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter said, "Can anyone withhold the water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" So we ordered them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they invited him to stay for several days. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
We'll now read responsively from Psalm 98. Sing a new song to the Lord, who has done marvelous things, whose right hand and holy arm have won the victory.
O Lord, you have made known your victory. You have revealed your righteousness.
You remember your steadfast love and faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the victory of our God.
Shout with joy to the Lord, all your lands. Lift up your voice, rejoice and sing.
Sing to the Lord with the harp and the voice of song.
With the trumpet.
Let the sea roar and all that fills it, the world and those who dwell therein.
Let the rivers clap their hands, and let the hills ring out with joy before the Lord,
who comes to judge the earth.
The Lord will judge the world with righteousness, and all the peoples with equity. The second reading is from 1 John, the 5th chapter. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God,
and everyone who loves the parent
loves the child. But this we know, that we love the children of God when we love God and obey his commandments. For the love of God is this, that we obey his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. For whatever is born of God conquers the world, and this is the victory that conquers the world, our faith. Who is it that conquers the world but the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is the one who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ, not with the water only, but with the water and the blood. And the Spirit is the one that testifies, for the Spirit is the truth. Word of God, word of life.
Thank you.
Please rise as you are able for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to John, the 15th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, "As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friend. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. I am giving you these commandments so that you may love one another. The Gospel of the Lord. Let us continue with prayer. Gracious God, as we gather on this Easter morning, as we celebrate your resurrection and the power of your love in our lives, reveal to us the power of your love in our lives, that we may share that love with those around us. May the thoughts and meditations of our hearts and minds be acceptable to you. Amen. Context makes all the difference. In Martin Luther's commentary on the introduction to his commentary on the Old Testament, and Martin Luther being a professor of Old Testament doctorate, he wrote that there is law and gospel, that there is law that reveals our human limitations, our human sins, and gospel, the good news that God loves us, throughout the Bible, for us as Old and in the New Testament. And then he goes on to say that some passages can be read, and at times, whatever is going on in our lives, sometimes it can be heard as law, revealing our sin, convicting us, and at other times the exact same words can also be words of good news, of God's love. So for example, where points in scripture where it says, God will break the rod of the oppressor. If you happen to be the one being oppressed, that's good news. And if you happen to be an oppressor who wants to continue oppressing, you might not hear that as very good news. That might be a word that convicts you of sin, that it can play both ways. Our gospel lesson today, where Jesus says, you know, as the Father has loved me, and so I have loved you, abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments. This follows right on the heels of the lesson we had last week, which talked about Jesus being the vine and we are the branches, and that Jesus is the source of life, of love, and that as we are connected to that vine of Jesus, we are filled with love, and if not, we're like branches that get cast into the fire. These passages are part of Jesus' farewell discourse in the Gospel of John, chapters 14, 15, 16, and 17. Jesus knows that he's going to be arrested. He knows he's going to be crucified. He knows he's eventually going to ascend to heaven. He knows his disciples are not going to have him with them in bodily form. And he's preparing them for this time to come. Now, there is a tendency for these words to be heard more as law. You better be a branch connected to the vine. You better follow the commandment. You better do what I say. And if you don't. But that's not what's going on here. Jesus says that if you abide in me, I abide in you, just as my Father abides, that just as I abide in the Father abides in me. As God, I abide in God, God abides in me. That I love, as I love you, love one another. This is not a situation where they're failing to do that, and he's wagging the finger. They have been doing this. At the beginning of our lesson last week, Jesus says, you are cleansed. You are part of me already. And they have been. They've been participating in Jesus' ministry in the Gospel of John for 3 years now. They've been part of the miracles. They've been part of ministering to the blind, the lame, those who are persecuted, left on the fringes, the rich and the poor. To everyone, they've been there. They're already doing this. They already love each other. And what Jesus is saying, you're already doing it. Keep doing it. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. And I appoint you to go bear fruit that will last. This is the secret sauce. That love comes from God through him to all of us. And we're called to keep this going, to keep loving each other. And why is he telling them this? Is because he knows what's going to happen. At Synod Assembly, I heard a fancy word. I think I'd heard it before, but it never really stuck in my head, but it's there now. And as many of you have gotten to know me, you know that I like to use, and sometimes I'm not even aware that it's out of my mouth until after I said it, fancy words. So the new fancy word that's in my head is liminal. A liminal time, an in-between time, a time that occurs when there has been a change, when something's come to an end, when you embark upon a journey and you leave where you're at behind for a new destination. That Jesus' disciples are entering a liminal time, that when Jesus is arrested, he's no longer with them. He's been with them for 3 years. He's been the rock in their lives. They have been his followers, and he knows that this is a huge change, that there's going to be a time period, especially those 3 days between being crucified and when he is resurrected, where it's going to be chaos, that liminal times are difficult. They can shake us. They can surprise us. We can wonder if we're stuck in that place forever. They can often involve confusion. They can involve suffering. They can also be exciting. They can be challenging. They can often reveal gifts that we have or spark gifts and abilities in us that we never knew we had before. And often we'll be overwhelmed with that liminal space as those good things start happening, and we don't recognize those good things happening because we're so overwhelmed. It often isn't until after the fact, look what I can do now. The thing about a liminal space is that it's limited. It is not forever, that there is something that comes next. For us as Christians, when we face death and life, there's a liminal time before we experience resurrection. And sometimes it can be longer and sometimes it can be shorter, but it's never forever. And we have the hope, we have the faith that green pasture will come, that resurrection will come, that new promised land will be there. That if you look at every major figure in Scripture, every story, they all go through a period where they leave something behind. There's a liminal time, and then there's a new destination where they come to a new place. Moses, he had a couple liminal times. A couple times where he left where he was. God comes to him in a burning, speaks to him through a burning bush and says, hey, you're going to leave the shepherding behind. You left being a prince behind. You're going to leave this behind and you're going to go back to Pharaoh and you're going to go talk to Pharaoh. And Moses was like, yeah, I've got a speech impediment. How am I going to do that? Well, You don't need to worry about that. We'll take care of it. And they go through a liminal time. They go through another liminal time, God's people, as they're brought out of Egypt and they wander the wilderness for 40 years. But it's not forever, and brought to the promised land. This congregation, we've been in a liminal time since the point Pastor Sorchek left. And yeah, it's been several years now. 5-6 years. We're still in a liminal time with the strategic mission plan. And this is not forever. And there's been good things along the way to sustain us. The Good Shepherd has walked us through the valley and has been taking care of us, and the green pasture is coming. And what Jesus is saying to his disciples is that as you are in that liminal space, the secret sauce is to love one another as he has loved us. That as he abides in the Father, we abide in him, and he abides in us, and God's love abides in us, and that we share that with one another. That's what makes it work. That's what sustains us. That's what keeps us going. That's what gives us hope when we don't know what the next steps are going to be exactly, or what the final destination's going to be. I don't know what the ministries of this congregation are going to be 2 years from now. I don't know. I cannot tell you. And you know what? I don't even want to tell you at this point. I don't want to know at this point, because if I try to know now, it's going to be my best guess. My best guess, limited by my imagination. Oh yeah, it'd be nice to be out of this liminal space. Oh yes, it'd be nice to have all the answers. Oh yes, it would be so comforting to know exactly what it's going to look like 2 years from now and exactly what the steps will be. But I don't want to know, because what God has planned for us, I know already, is bigger than anything I can imagine or you can imagine. And it's going to be revealed to us. And how is that going to work? Well, the secret sauce is to love one another with the love that God loves us. That's what the God sighting's all about. Abide in God. God sightings are looking at how God loves us. And that as we notice how God loves us, it fills us with God's love, that we can share that love with one another. It opens our eyes to how God is loving those around us. So that when we say to somebody else, God loves you, it's not some platitude. It's not some theologically correct thing to say. It's said with conviction. That you talk to the other person and say, hey, you said this, this, and this. And whether you realize or not, these are ways that God has loved you. And I know that because I've seen God love me. I've encountered God's love as well, and those type of things. That has power. That's sharing love. It's already there. We're doing it. I want to strengthen it for this congregation and strengthen it in your life. But that's why I came here to be your pastor, because I could see that happening already. I'm like, hey, I can work with this. This church has it already. It's already here. And at that point, 3 years ago, 4 years, when I started interviewing 3.5 years ago, we were really in the dumps here. Our morale was really low. But I saw you and I say, hey, we've got it. It's here. I want to be pastor here. I see the love. It's here. I can work with this. We can do this because God is already doing it within us. I'm excited about what's going to happen, even though I don't know what it is yet, what's going to happen in the next 2.5 years as we continue the strategic mission plan, to see how God is going to be revealed. At Synod Assembly, there's the vitality team of the Synod office is about redeveloping congregations, and they've got what they call the Love Revolution, which is basically the stuff that we're doing in the strategic mission plan. As we were there, Nancy and Lynn were listening, and I think they could recognize some of the stuff we've been doing in the Love Revolution stuff that they were talking about. Yeah, I like the term. Yeah, that's what this is. It's a love revolution, and we've already got it. It's already here. We are entering a liminal space as a congregation in another manner. I don't know who's going to be in that church office as our new church secretary. And yeah, it's unsettling to be in that liminal time when things are up in the air and things might fall through the cracks and it might be uncomfortable and already I know we miss Fran's presence in that office. But I'll tell you this, as Fran, as you sat in that office, you have the secret sauce. No, you weren't perfect. And I found myself encouraging you at times, and you were amazed that maybe I wasn't as frustrated as I may have been, maybe as other pastors may have been, because I knew, I saw, and I valued the one thing you had in spades that was more important to me than anything else as a church secretary, and that was the secret sauce, which is you loved everybody who came to this church, that you just exuded that naturally, that when people came to this church, they felt the empathy, the compassion, the concern, the willingness to help, the reassuring presence. No matter how anxious you were in any given moment, when people came to the office, that's what they encountered. People dropping food off at the drop box, who you'd only see for a couple moments, have already said that they've missed you. That's the secret sauce that this church has. And as we continue loving one another as we have been loved by God, I am sure God will send us someone else into that spot who will be who we need. And as I was tempted to say that Fran had the secret sauce, and I correct myself, she has the secret sauce, just as we are in a liminal time as a congregation, you're in a liminal time as well. Navigating, what is retirement going to look like? What are you going to do with that time? And yeah, liminal spaces can be uncertain. They can be unsettling. You know, you can grieve leaving what you've left behind when it's been good. But just as there's the crucifixion, there is the resurrection. The liminal time is not forever. You got the secret sauce. And I'm excited to see what God's going to do in your life next. And that sparkle that I see in your eyes, I saw in your eyes this morning when you can't got here. I look forward to seeing that sparkle in your eyes. And that's the thing. She's not going to disappear. I hope she's the bad penny who keeps showing up. So, I like bad pennies. What can I say? I like mischievous people like myself. I bring it out in them. So, as we are in liminal space, liminal time, let us keep our eyes, our spiritual antenna up, and keep seeking how God is loving us. Keep doing those God sightings, and let us keep loving each other. And it will bring us to amazing new destinations. Amen. Let us profess the faith using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. Why we believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Rejoicing that Jesus is risen and love has triumphed over fear, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need of good news. Your Holy Spirit falls upon all who hear the word. Fill your church with the gifts of your Spirit and give understanding hearts to those who strengthen our commitments with our ecumenical and interreligious partners. God of grace, you speak with the face of the earth is renewed. Receive your creation, that habitats and every kind of living thing might flourish. Protect endangered species and help us to care for all your creatures. God of grace. Your world is divided and the nations rage. Grant wisdom and vision to world leaders, that they may seek justice, peace, and the good of all. Strengthen international partnerships and cooperation. We pray especially for the Ukraine and the Middle East. God of grace, your children are in need. Comfort all those who suffer, especially those afflicted by anxiety, depression, and mental illness. Help us to be conduits of your love in our care for one another. We pray especially for Dave, Sergio, John, Ken, Dick, George, Judah, Jeff, Monique, Carl, Carol, Dave, Ann, George, Amy, Victoria, Peter, Andy, Mom, Pop-Pop, Grandmom, Granddad, Donna Marie, Mommy, Mama, Puma, Mo, Donna, Mike, Fran, Eugene, RC, Stephen, Elizabeth, Nicole, Braden, Dolores, Missy, Alice, Melissa, and Cheryl, and others that we name out loud or in our hearts. God of grace, your work is done in this place with our hands. Bless the ministries of this congregation, that we may embody your love for the world. Inspire those who plan and lead worship, council members, committee members, and volunteers. God of grace, your blessed saints now rest in you. Give us thankful hearts for those who have gone before us. At the last, bring us all together around your heavenly banquet table. God of grace, into your hands, most merciful God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abiding love, through Jesus Christ, our resurrected and living Lord. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us share the peace with one another. Let us pray. Oh, wait. If you have not done so already, please leave an offering in the offering plate by the baptismal font towards the entrance of the sanctuary. There's also a link in the online bulletin and on the website. Let us pray. Risen One, you call us to believe and bear fruit. May the gifts that we offer here be signs of your abiding love. Form us to be your witnesses in the world, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Let us pray as our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ teaches us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God.
Father, Christ, give us peace.
And now for those who are communing in the pew or online. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Please rise as you are able. Let us pray. Shepherding God, as you have prepared a table before us and nourished us with your love, send us forth from this banquet to proclaim your goodness and to share the abundant mercy of Jesus, our Redeemer and friend. Amen. You may be seated, and at this time, I would like to ask Jeannie Dreska to come forward, and our council president, Mike Sittler, to come forward, and Fran to come forward.
Thus says the Lord.
Let's get a microphone. For the people online.
A reading from Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, who created you, O Jacob? Who formed you, O Israel? Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the waters, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Here ends the reading.
Oh, some brief comments. And these are words you've heard before. Because every once in a while, sometimes seemingly out of nowhere, I would say these things to you over the past 3 years. You are wonderful to work with. An absolute pleasure, and thoroughly enjoy the rapport that we've had in the office. The sense of humor, Well, like I said, I'm a troublemaker at heart, and I tend to draw it out of others. and the love of your heart to see you do your ministry in this church was a joy to watch and to witness. And I miss you already, your presence in the office. And I always be fond of the memories of working with you, and look forward to being friends. We've always been friends and friendly in the office, but being friends and having more moments of humor and not having to worry about doing work around it. And I've already said nice things about you in the sermon, so I think I'll. Yeah. Oh. Thank you so much.
I'd like to bring the congregation into this festivity. Let's describe Fran's years with us. And put everyone into the picture here so that we can all appreciate her work. What can we say Your warmth is effusive, your kindness divine. You're such a good listener and pleasant all the time. So thoughtful, so giving, so welcoming and fun. You're delightful and insightful, loved by everyone. Whether working in the office or remotely at home, you would conquer the backlog, problem solving like a pro. Your work is ever thorough. You're efficient with tasks, part serious, part creative, always a champ. You've been generous with your hours in both effort and time. Your skills just kept on growing and your tasks were so refined. I may not be able to read the thank you from our hearts, Fran, for heeding Advent's call, for bringing us your smile and friendship beyond all. Okay, this is for you.
Where are we? Where? Right here? Oh, okay. It even goes much further, the ways you show your care. It's a true sense of calling. It is God's love that you share. And Pastor Matt is thankful. You've shared mutual support with encouragement and guidance and special rapport. We're grateful and we'll miss you, but we have a plan. But we have a plan for that. Come over here to join us for events, worship, or a chat. May retirement bring contentment and fun with your infamous friends. We hope you will count us among them, so that our time together won't end. Now, that was written by Jeannie. And this is for you.
View because of the butterfly design. I'm sorry.
All right. You come over here.
Fran raises butterflies. And
you go
yes,
get the
bag. This tote bag has a butterfly on it. So this was intended to be from an assortment of items from the people who interrupted you over the years when you were trying to get your work done. So it's just a smattering of miscellaneous.
And they were legion.
So we hope you'll have fun with it. Who knows what's in the bag of surprises, but enjoy it, and it'll give you something to remember us by, whether it's tacky or not tacky, depending on who put it in there. So best wishes, and please come back often and every day, every possible time.
Thank you, everyone. It's been a joy to work here. May you have as much happiness in your heart as you're giving me. Thank you.
Can you hear me? So when you think what an office administrator does, it really goes beyond your imagination. There's what, 25, 30 people here today? In our congregation, probably 40 or 50 active people. Think of everybody who came through our doors, and Fran was that point person. And every one of those individuals she touched with love. And you've heard it said repeatedly today, this is a gift that she has. It's not what you're retiring from, it's what you're retiring to. And her gift of love, she will continue to spread throughout this world. Have you ever met a more gracious smile? A person who welcomes you with her heart? Quite frankly, it's something that really is enabling to us all here. And we are very blessed to have had you here in this 9 years of quite ups and downs, challenges that we've had. Pastoral change, the COVID years, and so forth. And now as we've begun our process of rebuilding our church under Pastor Matt, you were part of that. And we're ever blessed, and we're very thankful. On behalf of the council, but also our congregation, we're providing you a small token of our appreciation. Please accept this with heartfelt thanks, and we wish you the best.
Oh, wait. We got to continue the service. Don't go away. All right. When you came to this congregation, we rejoiced to welcome you into the mission we share as the people of God. In this community, you have come to know and to share God's loving purpose for you and for all creation. God has blessed you in this community, and God has blessed us through you. Gracious God, we thank you for the work and witness of your servant Fran, who has enriched this congregation and shared her gifts with all whom she has served. Now bless and preserve her at this time of transition. Day by day, guide her and give her what is needed, friends to cheer her way, and a clear vision of that to which you now call her. By your Holy Spirit, be present with her in her retirement, that she may know the one who is the way, the truth, and the life, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now you can go. Yes. Thank you. There we are. Please rise as you are able. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine down upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Amen.
Friends forever, forever.
Alleluia! Christ is risen! Christ is risen indeed! Alleluia! Go in peace. Tell what God has done. Thanks be to God. Thank you.